Presentation. I'm glad to welcome you. My name is Mandy Butschke and I am the core developer of MK Postman. Before starting my presentation, I would like to give you some general facts about the component. Maybe you have already wondered what this MK means. It's the abbreviation for das Medienkombinat, which is the company behind this component. This Medienkombinat developed and published this component up from the beginning. The first version of the component had been developed for Joomla 1.0, and it was based on the components Letterman and MyLinks, which had been combined and extended by several functions, especially in regard to the newsletter part. And thereby, MK Postman was a functional and pretty comprehensive newsletter and bookmarking component. But then the development stopped for temporary reasons, and therefore it wasn't possible to get in with the Joomla version 1.5. Nevertheless, the company, das Medienkombinat, never lost sight of the further development of MK Postman, and so they planned to get this component to work within the new Joomla framework. And so they offered me the redesigning of MK Postman when I was looking for a suitable topic for my master thesis. Because of the limited time, it's not possible to present every part of my master thesis. It's too much theory. And so I will present only the part which affected the redesign the most. This part included a concept about how the old MK Postman version could be transferred into the new Joomla 1.5 framework by using preferably simple methods. Thereby, I had to run a feasibility study which included the check of the necessary measures for the transfer and the examination whether a one-on-one transfer was useful or a conceptual revision was needed. Well, the first point could be concluded very fast because since the scalability of the new component had been an important target, the implementation according to the MVC design pattern was unavoidable. The second point, however, involved further investigation because it required a so-called usability study. And the results of this study had a main effect on the redesign, and that's why I will mainly outline the study and its implications during my presentation. But let's take a short look on the agenda. I will also show you the redesigned component more in detail, and I will tell you something about the challenges I had been confronted with during the implementation. My presentation then will finish with a short final reflection. So if you have any questions, I will be glad to answer them afterwards. So then let's start with the usability study. The usability of something is always very, very important, or very important point, because it's no use if you have maybe a software which is full of functions but isn't used because of a lack of usability. Because the user doesn't know how this component or software works. And this applies also for a component like MK Postman. And so the usability testing was an important issue in the redesign. So in order to identify the usability of MK Postman, I had asked the users of the version which was current at this time about their opinion concerning the component. And for me, the best way to do this was a statistical survey by the help of questionnaires, since MK Postman has been used worldwide and thus face-to-face interviews or surveys couldn't be arranged. Well, I read a lot about this questionnaire stuff, and then I decided to use a commonly accepted test, which is called the Isonorm questionnaire. It's commonly accepted in Germany. And this questionnaire is based on the commonly accepted norm DIN EN ISO 9241 part 110. Well, this norm is usually used for the assessment of the so-called human creation of human-computer interaction, which is regulated by the German law. That's why I chose this one. This part I mentioned, part number 110, consists of 7 principles which should always be considered when creating software, and thus also during the redesign of MK Postman. These principles are the suitability for the task, the self-descriptiveness, the conformity with user expectations. Then we have the suitability for learning, the controllability, the error tolerance, and the suitability for individualization. I come back to the meaning of each principle in a few minutes, but before I would like to give you a short insight into the questionnaire. In the questionnaire, the users were asked about the principles by the help of opposing statements. Here you can see an example for such a statement. It asks the user if the software is good or if it is bad. And on a scale from 1 to 7, where 1 is absolutely negative and 7 is absolutely positive, the user assesses the statement. So if the user may think the component works, but it doesn't work very well, maybe the user should cross the fourth part. Yeah. Additionally to this, the test person could also indicate how important such a principle, for instance, the error tolerance of the system, was for them. Well, after evaluating all questionnaires, the usability of MK Postman could be assessed, and this evaluation helped me to discover the strengths and weaknesses of the system which was current at this time. However, it could not tell me what caused the weaknesses, so in order to find out more about this in detail, an extended research would be necessary, but due to a limited schedule, I wasn't able to carry this out. But the users told me a lot about the strengths and weaknesses, and I will outline these things later. So far about the questionnaire, now I would give you some ideas about the survey itself. The survey took place over a period of 4 weeks on an online platform in German and in English. And the participants were all subscribers of the MK Postman mailing list, and I asked them by email to take part in the survey. All in all, 140 people took part, and 58 of them completely filled out the questionnaire. Even though this number wasn't very high, I could find about the fundamental consensus concerning the usability of MK Postman. And this consensus stated that the component wasn't really utilizable. So I want to present you the results now. This is a chart where you can see the 7 principles I've talked before. None of this principle reached 5 or more points which were needed to be assessed as utilizable. The chart also shows the relevance. It's on the right side. And you can see that the users put greater importance to these principles as one may have thought. I will outline now each principle. And in doing so, I will tell you the meaning of each principle and the main problems of MK Postman concerning this principle and the implications to increase the usability. So I will start with the suitability for the task. What does it mean? Suitability for the task means that software can be handled easily and that the software adjusts to the user and not the other way around. It also means that software helps the users with their work and doesn't hinder them, for instance, by missing functionalities. So as you can see in the chart, it's on the left there, the user assessed that the suitability of the task wasn't very good. This is also supported by the fact that the users put a very high relevance into this point. So the question was why the suitability for the task has been assessed in this way. So, well, the main problem of MK Postman was that special functions which were regularly needed did not exist in such a way as the user may wish to. For instance, it wasn't possible to create a permanent sender email address which was different from the one of the system administrator. Consequently, one had always to enter the sender address manually when sending the newsletter. Another problem were the missing copying function of newsletter and the missing possibility to independently add more input fields for the newsletter subscription. So to reach a better usability for the task, these problems should be removed so that MK Postman would help the users in doing their work. So far about that. The second principle which was assessed in the usability study was the self-descriptiveness, which means that software uses comprehensible terms and symbols. Well, since each user has different knowledge about special terms, software should also offer a context-specific help, which the user can use if needed. And the self-descriptiveness also includes information about which values and formats are accepted for input fields. Well, in the chart here, you can see that the self-descriptiveness didn't come off very well, but it was assessed better than the suitability for the task, and the user didn't show that much relevance to this point. So why it didn't come this point off very well? The biggest problem of MK Postman was the missing help function. Many users did not understand certain terms and thus would have needed a help function. I give you a small example. To start the mailing process, the user had to click on a button called publish. However, many users did not know this in the beginning. Well, in order to improve the self-descriptiveness of MK Postman, a help function and even tooltips should be integrated, and also the naming of some parts of the components should be rethought. Well, the next principle to be looked at was the conformity with user expectations. This means that software is designed uniformly and consistently and thus is permanently structured and can be used according to a single principle. The user created this principle concerning MK Postman quite good, as you can see here. But there was still need for improvement. So the users ask mainly for a statistic function, which should inform the user if the system really sent the newsletters to the selected addresses or not. Another principle which was created very good in the suitability is the suitability for learning. If software is suitable for learning, it can be learned without any help or manual, and only little time is needed for doing this. And this principle includes also the easy finding of further information, for instance, by an integrated help function. As I still mentioned, MK Postman was created good concerning this principle, and as you can see in the chart, it got the best grades here. It, however, could be improved by offering help functions or maybe tutorials to tell the user what he or she could do. Well, the fifth principle, namely the controllability, for example, the fifth principle is the controllability, and it includes, for example, the possibility to change between different input form and navigations without any big barrier. And moreover, the user can, for instance, organize tabular lists by themselves, and the software can be operated both by mouse or keyboard. Taking a look on this chart, you can see that the controllability of MK Postman was graded rather badly. But the reasons for this might not only be in the component, but also in Joomla. An example for this was that one could not set how many entries should be displayed at the same time in a list without consequences to the other parts of the component. The same happened with entries for search keys. So the problem here was the mutual hidden dependence of the single components parts. So these dependencies should be changed or removed if the controllability of MK Postman should be improved. All right, now let me come to the principle called the error tolerance, which is very important for the usability of software. This principle includes that input fields are always checked for whether they are completely or correctly filled in, and that the user is informed about possible errors. This information should, of course, be formulated in a comprehensible way, and it should also inform the user about what they could do to solve the problem. Additionally, special actions like deleting of entries or something like this should only be carried out after the user explicitly approved them. Ideally, one should be able to undo also deletion processes. Well, as you can see in the chart, the error tolerance of MK Postman was graded very badly, and the reasons for that were various. For instance, the input fields were not always checked for whether they were completely and correctly filled in. Also, error messages were partly badly formulated so that the user didn't always understand them. And additionally, from time to time, the user even received success messages, although an error occurred. So you can see an improvement of the error tolerance of MK Postman was urgently necessary. In order to reach this, error messages should be indicated if errors occurred, and they should inform or should be formulated in a comprehensible way so the user understands them and knows what to do to undo the error. Another improvement for the error tolerance was the idea of always asking the user for their approval when deleting entries. And additionally, some users wished for a recycle bin where the deleted entries were listed and could be finally deleted or even restored. All right, now I come to the last point. It's the suitability for individualization. This means that the software can be adapted by the user, for instance, regarding the color, the language, or the arrangement of the system areas on the screen. And as you can see here in the chart, the suitability for individualization got the worst grade and the highest relevance yes. The users mainly missed the possibility to individually add database fields in order to add more user data. And moreover, they criticized the missing possibility for adaption, but as you may imagine, this is always a little restricted to the technical basic or basis. But one option, however, the adaption of the backend language, which was always in English in the former MK Postman, could be included. You may have seen, there were really need to improve the usability of MK Postman, and taking all these aspects into consideration, one can say that the component was in no way created user-friendly, and therefore a one-on-one transfer into the Joomla 1.5 framework was not advisable. And this, together with the assessment that the redesigning should be affected on the basis of the MVC design pattern, led to an almost absolute conceptual revision of MK Postman. This means that the old component should not just be transferred into the new system, it should be absolutely newly created. And that's what I finally did. The main parts of my conceptual revision could already be taken from the results of the usability study, But however, some more steps were necessary, for instance, to adapt the new component to the current legal and technical conditions. Well, since this was also a very extensive topic within my master thesis, I will not explain this more in detail, but I'll however give you briefly the most important elements, which are when subscribing to a newsletter via the front end, there should be the possibility to integrate the terms of use and to display them together with a checkbox, and the potential subscriber will have to cross the checkbox in order to send their subscription. Then we have only the email address may be displayed as an obligatory entry, and all other contents should be voluntary. When collecting statistics, for instance, concerning the opening rate of newsletters, nobody who has the newsletter open is allowed to be to take part in logging. That's what the German law says. Then we have, if a user unsubscribes to the newsletter service, their data should automatically be deleted from the database. Well, and the subscription should be created according to the so-called double opt-in procedure. And one last thing is, it should not be possible to send one newsletter several times, because some users may think it's spam. So this is... as a technical restriction. You have to develop your system that it is not possible to send a newsletter one or more time. Well, now I present the new developed MK Postman component, and I will not explain the theoretical conception, but directly present the practical result. And this shouldn't be a problem, since all current functionalities and areas of the new component were developed on the basis of the mentioned conception. But I don't want to bore you with all this theoretical stuff, and so I would like to demonstrate the current version of MK Postman with a video. And for this purpose, I extended a clean Joomla installation with MK Postman. So let's see, let's start. All right, so we have here the front end, and we do a subscription process. We enter the name first and the email address, and below the user can choose the format, which can be text or HTML. And additionally, the user can choose one or more mailing lists, which are listed below the subscription form. After completing the registration by using the submit button, the user will receive an email, which will inform them about their subscription. And in the next step, the user has to confirm the subscription by following the included link, as you can see here. This approach is called the so-called double opt-in, which I mentioned before. Within this last step of confirmation, the user can change also their settings, as you can see in this video here. But for editing the settings, the user can also use an edit link within the registration form. They will receive then an email with a special link to the edit form. This procedure implements a secure and user-friendly procedure, especially because no password is needed for it. Well, as you can see here, the structure of the edit form is nearly analog to the subscription form. In addition, the user can unsubscribe themselves via this form, or also via the newsletters, of course. Yes. Now I will continue with the back end. Here the component can be found in the usual way through the components menu. Well, and after selecting MK Postman, an overview of the possible actions is shown, which includes the newsletters management, the subscribers management, the campaigns management, the mailing lists management, and an archive. Additionally, a statistic is shown on the right side, and here you can see the number of mailing lists and subscribers and so on in the system. Another functionality is the configuration, which can be used, for example, for setting the sender's email address, which can be different from the from the address which is specified within the global Joomla configuration. And you can also configure the registration form in the front end. As default, only the email address is shown in the front end, so you can choose here whether you want also the name of the subscribers or not, or if you want to display a disclaimer or something like this, as I will show you in the video. We want to integrate the disclaimer, so we selected this option and saved, and there now you have the disclaimer. Okay. Now I will present you the subscribers management more in detail, and as you can see, maybe here, the subscribers are divided into different parts. We have the confirmed subscribers and the unconfirmed subscribers and the so-called test recipients. I will tell you something about this more later. By using the edit link, both types of users can be edited in the same way. So we take a look on this edit form. It also lists the available mailing lists for this user, which are organized by the access level of of Joomla. Well, another functionality are the test recipients. If you create a newsletter, you may want to see if the newsletter is displayed well in the different clients. And so you can take this functionality with the test recipients. Here you put in your test emails and send these newsletters to them and take a look if the newsletter is displayed right or well. Then if everything is okay, you can send the newsletter to the really mailing lists. In this example, I will show you another thing. What happens if you try to put in faulty data? Here we have two times the same address with the same email format, and this will occur an error. So the system shows the error and tells you what to do in order to undo this error. Okay, now let's come to the main part of the component, which is the newsletter section. Here are the newsletters also divided into different areas. You have the unsent newsletters and the sent newsletters. And now we will create a new one. For a better usability, we choose a step-by-step approach for creating the newsletters. So we have these tabs over there. And this first tab here, you can set some general information for this newsletter, such as the sender's name or the email address or the subject. And additionally, you can choose the mailing lists and Joomla groups which shall receive the newsletter. And we have also the possibility to add some Joomla content for inclusion into the newsletter. So here we have all Joomla content which is available, and to select one, just double clicking and it will appear in this left box. And if we now proceed with another tab, this selected content will be inserted into the newsletter. So here you can see the HTML version of the newsletter, which is presented within an editor. And we can do everything what we want with this editor, like always. And we have also the text newsletter here, which has this selected Joomla content. Well, and if you now want to see what the newsletter looks like, you have a preview in this fourth step. So you see the HTML version and the text version of your newsletter you just created. The fifth tab now is needed for sending the newsletters. Here you have the possibility to send the newsletters to the selected mailing list or Joomla user groups or to your test recipients. And in my example here, I will first send my newsletter to the test recipients. But first, I want to check if I filled in all everything correctly, so I can do a check. But this check will also be done automatically when sending. So this is the sending process, which always shows you which email address is selected at present and informs you about the sending state. So here we got the emails, the newsletters I just sent. This is the text version and it looks fine. And we also received the HTML version, which is also fine. So we can send now these newsletters to the selected mailing lists. Therefore, we have to open the newsletter again. Maybe take a look if we just selected the right lists and then we send the newsletter to our recipients. After sending the newsletter is marked as sent, and so it is displayed in this tab called Send Newsletters. Here you have also the preview of this newsletter and in HTML and text version, but you can also publish this newsletter for displaying in the front end, as you can see here. So this is the published newsletter now, and you will get the HTML version. You can also copy a newsletter to create a new one from this. This copied newsletter will be listed in this tab Unsent Newsletters. So now I will come to the campaigns management. Campaigns are especially in email marketing of great interest. So here you can group newsletters with similar content or newsletters which are otherwise related to each other. But as you can see here, further work has to be done. For instance, creating a statistic function. At present, you can only put in a title and maybe a description for this campaign, but you have already the possibility to assign this campaign to a special newsletter, and that's what I will do now. To assign a campaign to a newsletter, you open your newsletter, go into the first tab and select this campaign. If we now save the newsletter and go back to our campaign, this newsletter will be listed here. And in the future, I have planned to integrate a statistic function so you can see if your email marketing campaign was successful or not. So now let's come to the mailing list management. Here you can define if the mailing list should be public, only visible for registered users or for special users. And these are the Joomla internal access groups. As you can see here, I included in every part of this component these tooltips, which give the user some kind of help. So far about the mailing lists. Now let's come to the last part. It's the archive. This section implements this recycle bin, which some users had wished for. And there are all items which have been deleted are listed, and you can restore them there, or you can delete them finally. So far about the MK Postman component. As you may think, or can imagine maybe, the implementation didn't always run smoothly. Of course, there were some challenges. For instance, the structuring the component with these tabs, maybe you have, I think you have seen this in this short video. My plan included separate search and filter functions as well as sorting possibilities for each tab. But I couldn't implement this by using the Joomla internal tab function, because there the tabs don't act independently from each other, which was necessary for my plan. And to get my plan work, I had to find a solution, and so I implemented my own tab system, which reloads the content of the different tabs within every change between the tabs. And in addition, the system uses cookies to save the tab internal settings like search phrases or sortings. Another challenge included the dealing with faulty data. As usual, the form should be reloaded if the user tried to save faulty data, but for a better usability, the sent data should be re-entered by the system so that the user doesn't have to re-enter the data by themselves. This wasn't very easy because Joomla doesn't provide such a functionality, and so I had to find a workaround, and this is the workaround. After sending the data to the system checks it for correctness, and if everything is okay, the data will be stored. But if some errors are detected, the sent data will be stored into this user session. Then the system sends the data to the view and it displays it within the form, and then the data will be removed from the user sessions. This may not be the best solution, but it works for my component. Well, and one last challenge I want to outline was the dealing with possible abandonment during the mailing process. The question was, what should happen to the mailings which weren't sent at a breakpoint? These mailings shouldn't be lost, and it should also be possible to send these mailings afterwards. Regarding this, I implemented the following. When starting the mailing process, the receiver data will be stored in a special database table. In doing so, the system also checks if there are email addresses twice or more often which shall receive the same newsletter. This may happen if you want to send a newsletter to more than one mailing list. Well, however, when the basic mailing process starts, the system gets the first entry from the database table and tries to send it. And if this succeeds, the system catches the next entry, but if it fails, the entry will be written back into the table, but at the last position. So this procedure helps to keep the data, even if the mailing process has been interrupted or something like this. And the remaining mailings will be then listed in a new tab, which is called the queue, and you will see this tab in the newsletters management. And there you have also the possibility to restart the mailing process, and then the new process starts and the system catches the first entry and so on. Well, so far about my component MK Postman and the way I redesigned it. Maybe some of you may think that this way was much too overdone, but in my opinion it proved itself, and this applies especially in regard to the increase of usability, which has also been stated by the users. Nevertheless, there is still need for improvement. For instance, there are different things which I had planned within the new conception, but which I couldn't implement because of a lack of time. This involves, for instance, the mentioned statistic function. Then it isn't possible at present to send attachments. There isn't a real help function, only the tooltips are included. And there should also be a template area. Additionally, bounce management is on the agenda, and there is also a feature wish list which contains the wishes of the users, which is way too long. So you can see there are many possibilities for further development, but it's like always a question of time and costs. But despite everything, I am convinced that the MK Postman is already in its current version a well-functioning newsletter system. So well, but last but not least, I would like to hint at my master thesis, which contains these points of my presentation in a more extensive form, but unfortunately it's only available in German. Well, so if you have any questions, I will please to answer them now.
You were asked some uses of the old components about the usability components. Did you show these components to them again after you decided it? And how did they respond to the new field, the new loop?
Usability testing was about the old component, so the users did know the old component, and they should answer these questions from the questionnaire by using this old component gleichzeitig. However, and then I discussed some of these topics with them in a forum, yes. And so I got these things which hadn't been very useful for the users. And then I implemented everything and published it. And most of the users gave their feedback for this. And they said it's quite other than the former component, but it's okay. There are also some people who ask, oh, what's this? Where do I find this function and this function? But we have a blog on our website where they can ask these questions, and I try to answer them very quickly.
So they don't as well, okay?
Yes. Some more questions, yes?
First, I'd like to compliment you.
Thank you.
I think the survey is a good way to find out what was wrong with the old version.
Yeah, thank you.
I see what I see now from the component is it's already much better than in the build up, and I know that I don't remember this.
Yes.
Particularly one if the name was stopped unexpectedly, that was a big problem in the old for me.
That's right.
One missing function I think is the import of subscribers.
There is a function to import the subscribers. I'm sorry, I don't have the system here because I didn't know if I have internet here. But there is such a functionality within the subscribers management. You have a button.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
the XML, you can export the users from the old system via an XML, and you can import this XML very simply, I think, I hope.
Yeah,
okay. Okay. Another questions? No? Then thank you for your attention, and I hope you will have a nice evening.
Thank you.